Friends, I'm going to have a topic which is slightly different from the earlier two presentations. So this is about the Maharashtra Water Resources Regulatory Authority. Probably assessment is a little bigger word to use here. It's more like a reality check as what's happening. In fact, we are also thankful to Tushar for prompting us to get into this, and we don't regret it. And I think there are quite a bit of insights for even us, who have been working in the water sector for the last 25 years in Maharashtra, saying there are a lot of new insights, not only about the regulatory authority, but I think the type of deep-rooted changes which is taking place in the canal irrigation in Maharashtra and things. I would say that there are two reasons why we got into this exercise. One, like Mother said, the Maharashtra model of reforms, and actually which is being spearheaded by this old regulatory authority for the first time in the water sector, has been watched pretty closely. In fact, the state level, national level and international level, there are many takers for regulation in the water sector. In fact, I think the Planning Commission in the preparation for the plan did set up a group to come up with a model, a bill in terms of regulation, things to go from the Maharashtra experience. We also find that the Level Finance Commission has put as a condition that all states should come up with their own regulatory authorities and type of thing. Right from World Bank and other type of international agencies has been praising or coming up the need for regulatory authorities and type of a thing. In fact, in India also there are a few more states, I think already, I think UP has already passed a legislation, I believe Andhra is thinking of regulating, maybe slightly different type of regulatory authority and legal instrument which is coming. So there are a whole lot of things which are happening around regulation. The second thing is that I think it's about nearly 7 years since the legal instrument was put in place and the authority was set up. And I think 7 years is good enough time in the life of any institution to showcase what it can do and what it cannot do. I think it's also time to do this reality check so that if other states are going to emulate Maharashtra or come up with the different forms of regulatory bodies and type of a thing, then probably we have some learnings from this. Before I get into the presentation, there are two terms I think which need to be clarified because I don't keep coming up. One is entitlement, because I think entitlement has been one of the cracks or the crucial issues which the whole regulatory system has brought in for the first time. We are talking about water entitlements in terms of, especially in the agriculture or the irrigation sector. Now, entitlement is primarily, the way the Act defines it, is an authorization by either a road basin agency or the MWRRA to use certain amount of water under certain conditions. Now, in Maharashtra, though the Act talks about setting up 5 river basin agencies, there is not a single agency, river basin agency or an organization in place. So primarily it has been, all the entitlements have been given by the regulatory body itself. The second issue is that in Maharashtra, or I think in Indian irrigation system, especially when you talk about public irrigation system, we make 3 classifications. One is, there's a minor irrigation system which basically gives a service area of about up to 2000 hectares. We talk about a medium irrigation system which has a coverage of about 2000 to 10,000 hectares. Then you have the major or the large irrigation systems which has a command area or service area of more than 10,000 hectares upwards and things. In terms of how did we go about this study? In fact, as I said earlier, SOPECOM has been involved in the water sector in Maharashtra for quite some time now, and also right from the beginning of the regulatory body, and in 2005 onwards, engaged with the working of the regulatory authority. The last 3-4 years, we also have a larger platform in Maharashtra of primarily consisting of civil society organizations, movements, and also some of the academic or researchers called the Pani Dwaran Sangharsh Manch, which has been a major platform to engage with, not only with MWRR type of stuff, even with the larger the type of changes which is taking place in the policy or other type of domain. And it is because of the intervention of this platform that, and some of you might have heard about it, for the first time a state water policy did give the second priority to industry or agriculture, and because of this body the last 5-6 months back, this order has been reverted, and through a government order now the second priority has been accorded to agriculture again. The third thing is that as part of this EME support small research program, we are also doing some field work In fact, the field work is also, we are taking upon projects which has been covered under this whole sector improvement project, which has been also going on in Maharashtra from 2005. So in fact, MWRA is supposed to, you know, award entitlements, give the tariff orders and that kind of things, primarily beginning or starting with this second improvement project. So we have concentrated our field work primarily on those projects. We have taken up four projects for our detailed field work. So we have Wagha, which is one of the medium irrigation projects, which has a command area of something about 9,600 hectares. We have Mula irrigation system, one of the very major systems, which has something about 90,000 hectares as the cultural command area under that. You have Kukri, which has put something like about, I think, 224,000. It's about 2.24 lakh hectares as its command area, and you have a slightly smaller project with the goal. So this time we have been able to complete the field work in two projects, that is the Wagha and the Kukri. So most of the insights which is coming to the presentation is primarily located and these two, the empirical work we have been able to do under these two projects. In fact, Mother also started about this one, the reform package in Maharashtra. In fact, there are four or five things. For example, in 2001, before the new water policy came into this, Maharashtra was the first state to take a very bold step of increasing the water tariff very steeply. It increased by 50%, taking 2000 as the base year and things, and with a proviso that every subsequent year there will be a 15% increase in the irrigation charges, and they have been doing that. Second, in 2003, we have the Maharashtra State Water Policy in place. 2005, we see the participatory, what you call the Maharashtra Management of Irrigation System by Farmers Act, which makes it compulsory for irrigators to get access to water, to form water user associations in each of the projects and things. Then we have the Maharashtra Water Resources Regulatory Authority Act coming in 2005. Then again, in the same year, we have the larger, what you call the sector improvement project, which was taken up in Maharashtra with a huge World Bank loan. Now, there are many critiques about this whole reform movement. One of the arguments is that the whole reform movement has been informed or pressurized or type of thing through the World Bank, because the whole timing of all these things becomes little suspect. Now, I'm leaving this discussion for the time being because I think there are a whole larger debate around why this type of reform has taken place, what has been the motivation for such reforms and things. I think these are larger debates. I think we can take it up later, but at the moment I'm going to do what the regulatory authority has been able to do or not to do. Now, if you look at the Act, what are we supposed to do? There are basically three, and the mandate includes: one, regulate water resources in the state; two, facilitate and ensure judicious, equitable and sustainable management, allocation and utilization of water resources; third, fix the rates for different uses of water under the different categories of water use, whether it is domestic water, agriculture use and primarily industrial use and things. This is the main mandate which has been given to the regulatory, independent regulatory authority through the Act. And it's supposed to do through the various functions like: one, determine, regulate, enforce and distribution of entitlements. In fact, we are talking about both bulk entitlements as well as individual entitlements and things. And also, the original Act had the proviso to make an inter-sectoral allocation between the three sectors and things. Second, establish a rational water tariff system, review and clear water resource projects. Even to get sanction for new projects and things, it was the MWR as the route to do that. Become the priority of equitable distribution of water, especially across different scales, and also especially in scarcity conditions, how do you prioritize water use and how do you allocate water. Establish a system of enforcement, monitoring and measurement. And finally, as a conflict or a dispute resolution mechanism, especially with regard to entitlement, its working of the entitlement and the tariffs. So these are the basic functions the regulatory authority was supposed to have carried out. Then comes in 2011, we already find signs of watering down the mandate of the regulatory authority. In fact, there was an amendment made to the original Act. So mandate to allocate water across different uses has been taken away by the, from the purview of the regulatory authority. Now it rests with the cabinet of the cabinet of ministers. Second, through this amendment, it also ratified All the earlier decisions of reallocations which have been made by what was earlier existed called a high power committee chaired by the irrigation or the water resource minister, which was Mr. Ajit Pawar to great extent. Third, there was a provision for a public hearing in case of any reallocations being made from one use to the other, and even that provision has been taken up. In fact, there also this amendment which said none of these reallocations can be even questioned in any of the courts of India and things. So they made this whole system opaque and also in a way clipped the wings of MWRA to date extent through this act. Now, in terms of this assessment which I am going to present before you, we are also doing certain key promises it made. One was that this whole question of independence from executive and the political systems and processes, I think that was one of the selling points of the regulatory authority, was that this so-called independence from, especially from the implementers or the executive body or the political system and processes, that was one of the first thing. Second, the fixing of entitlements including individual and bulk water entitlements as well as sectoral allocation thing, they thought that they can bring in some more rationality into the way things are happening in Maharashtra. Third, rationalization of water tariff. So these are the three points I'd like to bring out, and the type of insights coming around these three key issues. The first question is that, is MWRRA independent? Now, for example, if you look at the literature on the whole rationale for any independent regulation, one is that there should be separation of roles between the implementer and that of a regulator. Two, crucial decisions with regard to a particular sector, in terms of water sector, has to be taken on what they call techno-economic rationality, and also need to steer clear from the type of so-called vested interests which play around in things. Third, regulatory function to be handled by an independent agency of experts, protected from the undue pressures from bureaucratic and political earth. So these are the main rationale. Of course, there is also argument saying that bringing in an independent regulator or regulatory body is also precursor to privatization, because there are going to be many players coming into the sector, so you need some type of body to regulate the multiple players which are going to come into the picture and things. Now, coming to independence, the first question we need is that, who is this authority? What is its composition? And who selects this body? Now, if you look at the present body of the regulators, now there are one chairperson and two members, and there are five, what you call nominated members from the five river basins. Now, all members are retired government bureaucrats, either from the water resource department itself or from the finance ministry or finance department and things. Now, who selects them? There is a committee of seven people, seven secretaries of seven departments chaired by the chief secretary. Now, this committee, this selection committee also doubles up for the what you call the state water board. And the state water board is supposed to prepare what you call the integrated state water plan and things. So, the issue is that right from the composition itself, when you say about independence, I think that is one of the crucial issues which we need to ask. Second is, who does the regulation and enforcement of entitlements? Now, if you look at the whole, and in fact, actually, MWRA has brought out a very detailed manual about how this is going to be done, who is going to be appointed and things. Now, the regulator who goes into the actual minor level canal and try to see that whether the it's being enforced and things, the regulator belongs to the same irrigation system, but from a little different subdivision of the same project. Now, they also have a provision to appoint what they call a primary dispute resolution officer. In fact, if the farmers complain that they are not getting their entitlement and type of thing. Now, interestingly, who are these PDROs? Now, in terms of a major irrigation project I talked about, it is the concerned chief engineer. In terms of a medium irrigation project, it is the concerned superintendent engineer. And in terms of a minor system, it is the concerned executive engineer. We all know that through the amendment and also keeping the entire reallocation of the water from the agriculture to the industry, which was kept. In fact, there's a prior study which says that in this last 10 years, even after the MWRA was brought into picture, nearly 1500 million cubic meter of water was moved from agriculture to industry without even going through the route of the MWRA. Second, the first project to privatize in Maharashtra, the Neera Devgar case in near Pune, was also a case which came up after the MWRA came. In fact, one of the functions of the intermediary is to sanction the water source projects and things. In fact, it was because of the efforts of Prayas and type of people saying that you are circumventing the whole jurisdiction of the regulatory authority to do anything. So there are a lot of political interference continues and things. So the issue is that the core selling point of independence doesn't seem to be working the way the embryo is functioning today. The second issue is in terms of how the entitlements get played out and how that gets determined first, and also how it is being monitored and measured and enforced and things. Because of the amendment in 2011, now the word distributed entitlements is only within the particular use. Like for example, in agriculture, what is the type of bulk water entitlement to be given to different water associations and other things, and also in terms of individual irrigator entitlements and things. First observation, there are very serious methodological issues. There is a very detailed methodology manual which is being brought out, how this entitlement is to be calculated, estimated, and there is a very interesting iterative process which they have set. Now, one of the very critical parameters is basically one, the storage capacity of the project, and also what I call the type of losses and things. There is no measurements or there is no empirical data to go on this. Second, very often the flow irrigation is always worked out. The entitlement is a residual to other type of commitments which already take place in terms of bulk water use, either in the domestic sector or industrial locations and things. And within the irrigation use also you find, lift irrigations. For example, in Maharashtra we have a provision of lifting water from the reservoir as well as the canal. They get a much higher entitlement than farmers who depend on the flow irrigation things. We have some data on that which I won't get into that because of lack of time and things. For example, I just show you that in water system, if you see on the rabi season, people who are going to lift on reservoir, they get something like about 2,360 cubic meter per hectare. If you have a lift on the canal, you get 2,740. And flow irrigation people get about 1300. I mean, this is the type of thing which you find, a differential type entitlement you find. So you don't need to take serious note of this to correct the things. In terms of working the entitlements, you find it two different situations in terms of water and quickly. I won't give the details because water is one place where you have a very functioning, vibrant water use associations working. There is a federation which coordinates all type of this. You find things moving in a much better organized, monitored manner and things. But in terms of Kutte, you don't find anything. There is no measuring devices in place, handing over to the reviews have not taken place there, no record of entitlements even given to the water use associations, and also to their own sectional offices of the irrigation department. So you find all lot of chaotic situation in the Kutte system and things. Tariff is one area I would say that employer has been able to make some rational headways. And they have come with a very interesting methodology. In fact, they have come out with three important criteria in terms of deciding the tariff. One is, for example, affordability. Second is accessibility. Third is quantum and timeliness of the delivery. And so against these three, they have tried to come up with a methodology in which how do the three sectors, domestic sector, industrial sector, and irrigation sector should share in the operation maintenance cost. In fact, the whole tariff system is geared around recovery of the operation maintenance cost and type of thing. You also find that an interesting provision that people with more than two children are supposed to pay 1.5 times more than the regular water tariff. So water tariff is not only an instrument for water use efficiency, but it's also probably it's also for a family planning program or a family efficiency type of thing. In fact, an approach paper was brought in 2008, this will take this 2 minutes and things, and 2009 the first tariff order was brought into place. In fact, there was a very wide consultative process in deciding the before they brought up the World Water Tariffs order. They had, I think, regional consultations, even like going down to the various, not only the mega cities and type of thing, even going to some of the district places, there was a very wider type of thing. So for example, some of the suggestions which came up from the civil society and the things were taken into account, one is the weightage to affordability to be given a prime place in that, reducing the overall cost of maintenance and things, and also they introduce certain concessions. For example, if you have a tribal farmer, then you have a 100% free water and type of thing. Interestingly, unlike expectations, now I mean, what are the expectations is that with NWRRA, the water charges would go up, but in fact it has not reduced. In fact, prior to the end of URRA, the tariff in the forest, and if you look at the volumetric tariff for a 1,000 cubic meter, for Ravi it was about, earlier it was 71 rupees 40 paise, it has come down to 60. In terms of hot weather, it has come down from 144 to 90 and things. I would not go into the details that are in the, you know, highlight which you have given. There are some of these numbers and some of the details are this. Now, I just want to come to the last one or two slides about what are the type of conclusions and way forward which we have. One, in terms of independence, employer has shown very little independence. Two, tariff, yes, it could rationalize bulk water price to some extent, but nothing beyond. And entitlement is a very serious issue because there has been a lot of contested debate about that. What should be the basis of entitlement itself? Is that, I mean, the way it is being done is that the amount of land you hold in the particular command area decides how much entitlements you get entitled to. So from that debate to even the way it is being done, there are a whole lot of problems which need to be handled. Last thing that, so there are deep-seated changes which are underway within the command of irrigation project systems has been designed primarily in Maharashtra to function as independent of groundwater interactions. In fact, Marathi gave a saying that part mot sambandh nasav, that means the canal and the wells should never meet, and the entire system has been designed that way. But today groundwater within the command is becoming an important element of the irrigation system. People are using flow irrigation more like a supplementary type of, either to recharge your wells or as a supplementary type of system. Cropping patterns have been changing. This there is also concentration of water use taking place. In fact, some of the data which we saw in terms of entitlement things, we find that the area irrigated shrinking, but the water use does not seem to come down, or it is much beyond the entitlement which is given. So that is also calls for, you know, a lot of rethinking about the way we think about and engage with the mainstream irrigation. So the issue is that where do we go from here? One argument could be that should the MWRA shut down shop? I mean, there are arguments of that type saying that, okay, empirically doesn't seem to, apart from the philosophical ideological debate about whether independent regulatory authority or body should be there in the water sector or not. But even empirically, things don't seem to be checking out. And so one argument could be, or people are already saying that, no, we should. But we would argue that in terms of arguing, because we do find that limited role in terms of monitoring or playing a watchdog function, which is independent of the executive, especially, to do in the water sector. Probably we can argue that MWRA should suspend itself for the next 5 years and use this opportunity to rethink, reconfigure and re-engage with the type of changes which is taken place in the, you know, public irrigation systems in the country and things. We also need to revisit some of the larger questions and things. I mean, the whole question of how entitlements are decided, how people get excluded from the way the whole methodology has been worked out and other things. So there are many issues which is... We also find that there are questions like where issues of where regulation can work and where regulation cannot work. Now, one of the insights which we carry, I think one of the talk which I listened to Tushar once, saying that regulation can work when the number of primary obstacles can be much more tractable. Now, when we have millions of primary users in terms of, you know, agricultural farmers, and that is very difficult to monitor or regulate the water use through a regulatory authority type of thing. So you need vibrant institutions at the local level of the farmers. Water association is one way out of it. I'm not saying that that's the only way, and but you need to also, I mean, the presentation which made from Sopago study also said that even the picture there is pretty bad. So we need to engage with type of thing. We need to give time to put certain basic things, do our own homework and see, then properly rethink about, you know, how to go about employing this. So one of the important suggestions which will come up is that it is high time that employer itself suspend itself for about 5 years at least and see what new ways of doing things. The last point I would say is that, I mean, there are a whole lot of, you know, I've been hearing saying that, you know, public irrigation systems don't deliver. In fact, to quote what Himanshu said the opening day, it's like, you know, wrecking to the public irrigation system and the large irrigation systems. I think it's too early to say that. If the state of the public money to the tune of 300,000 crores have been spent, and there are people, millions of people who are still dependent on this system, which is still in the public domain, I think we need to clearly re-engage with the issues and not saying that, you know, enough is enough, now we need to get into the groundwater management or mining systems or watershed development and that kind of thing. Instead of getting this polarized discourse, I think we need to have this, how to integrate local and exogenous or larger the big. And one complaint coming from the civil society perspective, I know all of you are researchers and things, there are only very few people who study research and the activism to some extent. If you look at the public irrigation systems, and if you look at how many civil society organizations are today seriously engaging with this issue, Gujarat, you look at, I think you find two organizations, whether it is Development Support Center or AKRSP. Come to Maharashtra, there may be two or three organizations. Go to Madhya Pradesh, I can find only one or two. But what is the development? You find plethora of institutions and civil society and type of thing. Is that we have all written out public irrigation systems, we find that it has nothing to play, or we find our own comfortable zones to work because local, you know, whatever type of thing. I think we need to rise above type of thing, and even the civil society also need to engage with some of these serious issues the irrigation sector has thrown up. Thank you for the extra time, and I stop here.
Thank you very much.